Weidenfeld and Nicholson presents Why I'm Not a Millionaire, written by Nancy Spain, read by Nathalie Buscombe. Copy of a letter from Noel Coward. My dear Spain, to read somebody's autobiography in galley proof is not what I would choose as relaxation, but I must say your book was worth it. I found it gay, amusing, occasionally touching, and always enjoyable. I may, of course, be prejudiced in this view, because there are so many glowing references to me in it. As you know, I am a pushover for glowing references. However, here it is, my opinion for what it is worth. I thoroughly enjoyed Why I'm Not a Millionaire, and shall enjoy it still more when I can reread it in a book form, with the pages numbered. Some of your flippancy is outrageous, but who am I to talk of flippancy? It should and will be an enormous success, and I do congratulate you. My love, as usual, Master. Obviously, you can use any part of this fascinating letter. What you can't use, you might send to the British Museum, which is where I am sending your bloody galleys. Forward. It was when we were returning from a magic weekend with Cyril Lord, the textile king, that Joan Werner Laurie turned to me and said, "Why aren't you a millionaire? Cyril is only 5 years older than you, and he and his business are worth 4 millions." I hung my head. What could I say? I was nearly 40. I had had the most wonderful life. I had been to New York, Jamaica, Madeira, the south of France, Corsica, and Margate. I had, at least once, been offered £47,000 by an American syndicate and had turned it down. I had written 2 best sellers and 8 detective stories. I had met and chatted with Noel Coward, Marlena Dietrich, the Duke of Windsor, Mrs. Luce, Lady Docker, Gilbert Harding, Catherine Hepburn, Humphrey Bogart, Godfrey Wynne, Winifred Atwell, and 500,000 other people, most of whom I had liked very much. I had also met and chatted with millionaires. Yet I was not a millionaire. Why not? To tell the honest truth, I wrote this book to find out. For a start, the circumstances of my birth were much against me. I was born in perfect comfort, in a maternity home called Rose Villa, just off Jesmond Road, Newcastle on Tyne, to 2 thoroughly sweet parents who were neither rich enough to be a nuisance nor poor enough to go without. More, though they didn't despise the things that money can buy, both are notable spenders, they didn't think very much of money either. They were well aware that it would be hard for their daughters to marry, and mother particularly was always telling me that I should have to make my own life and living. But I had a supremely happy, safe childhood in a safe, warm, brick-attached terrace house like about 9 million others. I always had enough to eat. I always had lovely toys. Apparently, the money used to run short over summer holidays, but I didn't know about this and was very contented. Indeed, the only very occasional unpleasantnesses were a few skirmishing quarrels between my mother and my sister Liz. I adored them both. They both had big personalities. It was quite impossible to take sides or to know what they were quarreling about. Chapter 1. This house was a fierce red brick job called No. 7 Tankerville Place. It was firmly attached to the neighbours on both sides. On our left was Mr. Wolf, a Jewish picture framer with 2 daughters called Anita and Zelna. At the bottom of the street were the Bucknells. Mr. Bucknell had rowed stroke in a very fast Oxford boat in the boat race. His house was full of oars and model boats, which we found very impressive. Around the corner in Tankerville Terrace were an enormous, attractive family called the Gills. The Gills were allowed to play in Tankerville Gardens, among the rhododendron bushes, and so were we, until there was an incident. I forget what, but think it involved an air gun and shooting. We were my sister Liz and me. When Liz was 18, she fell in love with Harry, the eldest Gill, and this caused awful repercussions in the neighbourhood. But she soon got over it, and learnt to play a tune on the piano called Ain't Misbehavin', which was considered significant by one and all. These streets are in Jesmond, a respectable suburb of Newcastle-on-Tyne, right in the heart of the coal-burning pit country. But as there is always a terribly cold east wind blowing across from left to right, there are precious few fogs on Tyneside. George Spain, our father, bought this house after World War I, in which he served as a colonel and was mentioned in dispatches. He is also a CMG. He thinks of the house chiefly as a receptacle for his books, coins, medals, and sporting prints of Northumberland. He also has a vast collection of stamps in big albums and corresponds madly with other numismatists and philatelists. He used to write very funny articles for Punch, very scholarly articles for the Cornhill about witchcraft and Roman Britain, and remarkable poems and plays for broadcasting. But he seems to have got sick of it. More's the pity. Again is spring. The birch and pine put on fresh green. The little burns dance down to join the ancient tyne. And all along the old black dyke there is a stirring in the land. If only we could understand the dreams of old Northumberland. It is a shame that a man who could write that should write poetry no more. He also appeared in a number of radio plays, and he used to broadcast running commentaries on Newcastle United football team. He has a perfect natural radio personality. But most of the time, he was land agent to Lord Northbourne, like his father before him. Lord N is a Liberal peer who owns housing property in Hebburn and Jarrow-on-Tyne, and a shooting box with a little grouse moor round it in the valley of the River Reed, where our father was born. Quite often, our father would go up to Reedsdale on business and tramp across quite large pieces of Northumberland, which he did so fast that we all thought he detested the countryside. Northumberland is very beautiful, but it is also very, very cold, and only people like Esther McCracken, with natural red hair and strong personalities, can live there and like it. I can remember going for picnics up the North Tyne in August. I remember one heat wave at least, eating peaches pulled from a garden wall in a beautiful house called Hesleyside with a lime tree walk. Once, too, on a very hot day, poor mother had an asthmatic attack, and Sister Liz gallantly bicycled back to the Moorcock Inn, where we were staying, to fetch some remedies. Liz arrived spectacularly covered with blood, like someone bringing the good news to X, for she had fallen off and bitten the tire in two. The shock of this drama cured mother's asthma immediately. I can remember sitting afterwards in truly pouring heat on a riverbank while mother inhaled burning himrod so that Lizzie shouldn't feel that her journey wasn't necessary. But, truly, heat waves in Northumberland were few and far between. Our father spent most of his childhood in Reedsdale, which he is supposed to have enjoyed, and he used to tell how a pig went fishing with him, and how he put his arm round its neck and talked to it, calling it dear pig. Our father is a very good fisherman and a very good shot, too, but we never saw him kill anything, and he was always putting the fish back. Gentle, large, he still weighs about 16 stone, with a truly wonderful wit, he early decided that the naughty, money-grubbing world was run by greed and fear. And he didn't like this, so he pretended to be deaf and disappeared into his collections. Actually, anyone who likes can carry on a conversation with him in a very low whisper about witchcraft and Roman Britain, and he will hear every single word. He is a dear. He is a generous, dignified, simple darling, and I love him very much. But he is also, and this must be faced, one of the wackiest characters I have ever met. Without being destructive, he can be naughtier than Lord Beaverbrook, and that is saying something. On the telephone, for example, in the days when it wasn't on the dial and was still one of those enchanting things, rather like a daffodil with a trumpet hanging from it, he used to pounce on it and answer, praying for a wrong number. He would clasp it to his chest, and his eyes would dance with joy as he called all the household to join in the baiting. On at least one occasion, the dialogue went something like this. Miserable subscriber who has failed to comply with post office regulations. Hello, hello, is that you, Stan? Our father, with joy. Are you there? Subscriber. Yes, I was just ringing up to see what you were wearing for the dance. Our father, shortly. Kilts, of course. Subscriber, dazed. Kilts? Our father, testily. Yes, yes, naturally. Haven't you got a kilt? Subscriber. I think I'd much rather speak to Stan, if you don't mind. Our father. I'm afraid you can't. His lordship is at present on the hunting field. As well as this love of fantasy, our father had a horror of pretension and people who drop in. Dinner parties where there weren't enough cutlets to go round, people who dropped in deserved all they got. At a dinner party, he once remarked with a sweet smile, no one has a sweeter smile than our father. That was a splendid ending to the football match between Hartlepool Found Drowns and Tynemouth Graveyards United, when the players battered the referee to death with his truss. But he was best, really, with people who dropped in. Once Mother had an unexpected chum to tea, a chum with a golden cocker spaniel. Sister Liz arrived a little late, a little breathless. For some reason, we were all sitting round the dining room table. And then our father leant under his end of the table, barked like a dog, and pinched Liz in the fleshy part of her thigh. No one enjoyed it more than Liz. She leapt shrieking into the air, crying, "He's bitten me! He's bitten me!" causing as much damage as possible among the buttered toast and scones. The innocent dog woke up while this fearful scene was raging and began to bark. His horrified mistress removed him and later had him destroyed. She never dropped in again on the Spains. Our mother, cross though she was about this episode which alienated her chum, is also a dear. But she is also, and this, too, must be faced fearlessly, one of the great English eccentrics who has cashed in on an Irish domicile. She has for some years been getting away with every sort of electrifying outspokenness on account of her alleged Irishness. In fact, of course, there is not a drop of Irish blood in her veins. Actually, she is the daughter of William Holmes Smiles, granddaughter of Samuel Self-Help Smiles, daughter of Lucy, who was a sister of Mrs. Cookbook Beaton, and the mingled blood of various go-getting Victorian tycoons whizzes through her veins. She was always keen for her children to get on in life, but as one half of her children was Spain, and therefore not remotely go-getting, she spent most of her life with our father in a state of violent frustration. This came to a head one day, I think, in Newcastle's most newly opened luxury cinema. It was a time when there was much talk of the white slave traffic. Old ladies, they said, or hospital nurses, would ask to be helped across the street. They would whip out a hypodermic, inject some smart soporific, and we would wake up in Buenos Aires. So watch out for old ladies and hospital nurses. I sat between Liz and Mum, and all went well until a local quartet appeared and started to quaver through The Swan by Saint-Saëns. Our mother was bored, and she took from her throat an extremely valuable brooch, opened it, and passed it to me. I didn't like the music either, but I was at a loss as to what to do with the brooch. A hoarse whisper from our dear, gentle mother made matters clear. And I thrust it, right up to the emerald, into Liz's long-suffering thigh. The scream she gave on this occasion topped all other screams. She then turned smartly round in her seat and said to the row behind, "Who made that disgusting noise?" This was too much for our mother. She was led, moaning slightly, from the cinema by attendants, while we sat on, deeply enjoying Sylvia Sidney in Street Scene. Liz kept the brooch. Mother was also madly loyal. My children, right or wrong. And once, when Liz was performing a little bathing number at a children's party with a rubber hat and towel, another jealous mother said, "I'm so glad my children don't show off." To which our mother, with the speed of a fer de lance striking, replied, "And what have they got to show off?" Once, too, I was prancing at a children's party in lace with a blue sash. "Who is the big girl in the blue sash?" someone asked my mother. "That's George Spain's little girl," said mother. "Oh," was the reply. "Have you met the mother? She's quite mad." Mother greatly enjoys telling this story against herself. Our father always said it was the harsh life she had led with her 10 brothers and sisters in Ireland that had made her so trigger quick in repartee. Her father built the Belfast ropeworks and is still repeatedly referred to in the Belfast papers as a captain of industry. Her brother, Walter, won 2 DSOs, was knighted for his work in India, and eventually became a Conservative Member of Parliament. On one occasion, he was being heckled by a miner who asked him how he would like to spend his life working in the bowels of the earth. "So long as my bowels move, at least once every day," said Uncle Walter, "I don't care." He was drowned when the Princess Victoria sank in the Great Storm of 1953. His daughter, Patsy Fisher, tallest woman in the House of Commons, duly fought and won the seat for North Down as a unionist. All mothers, brothers and sisters are remarkably tough. Aunt Eileen drove a baby Austin through Yugoslavia before any roads were built, and bathed in the Arctic Ocean. Her sister Lily wrote the Rodine School song. A splendid, sprawling, flamboyant family are the Smileses, all 11 of them, with red cheeks, mad enthusiasms, and enormous personal attraction. Our mother is the beauty of the Smileses. She had green eyes and black hair when she was young, when she and Aunt Eileen played hockey for Ulster with large red hands, the coat of arms of Ulster, on their blouses, bursting with enthusiasm. Now her hair is silver, but bless her heart, she is still enthusiastic. Mother was born and brought up in Belfast. All Belfastese have passionate loyalties to their city and themselves. For example, the director of the BBC at Newcastle, known in those days of the blue calico-covered mic as 5NO, was a charming North of Irelander called George Marshall. Because Martha came from Belfast, he was always wangling me parts in children's plays in the children's hour. And one St. Patrick's Day, I appeared in a variety bill where I gave a bunch of hot, mangled shamrock to Peggy O'Neill, kissed Tommy Handley, who in those days read his jokes out of a little red notebook, and was taught a song and dance routine by Dorothy Dixon. "We are three jolly consumptives," terrible imitation of hawking and spitting here follows as chorus. "Hock chew, hock chew. We are three jolly consumptives. Hock chew, hock chew. We never work and we never will. We run up the hell of a doctor's bill. We are three jolly consumptives. Hock chew, hock chew." Most of our strangest school holidays were spent in Belfast too. To get there, we went to Stranraer, then to Larne by the Princess Victoria, and were very sick indeed. Our grandmother lived in a rather ugly Edwardian villa with gables and a stockbroker timbering in a part of Belfast called Strandtown. The villa itself was called Westbank and was a highly desirable residence, but I found it terrifying, what with the gardener who had fits and was often found unconscious beside his hoe, and the strange tales of shootings in the bad times at the bottom of the garden. Strangers are always insisting that I must be Irish because my name is Spain. Sister Liz rather likes this. And like our mother, she has been getting away with murder for years by pretending it is the Irish in her. So she has had to start a rival genealogical theory. Father says that the Spains are descended from terribly grand Huguenots called d'Espagne. He even has family trees to prove it. Liz maintains, like all other Spains in County Cork, that we were washed up in Ireland from the Spanish Armada. Liz and I had a jolly nice childhood, so long as we weren't crossing to Ireland by Stranraer and Larne. Liz decided to be a dress designer early in life, and on wet days, she used to fill in books and books of fashion plates, painted in watercolours. When she ran out of fashion books, she used to draw her own, with appropriate fashion notes to go with them. She was very fierce about her artwork and would slap down other would-be artists, calling them copycats. On fine days, we used to go for walks in Jesmond Dean, Brandling Park, and the Ballpark, where Liz would tell me what she was going to wear at her wedding. Once, I pushed Billy Hardcastle, now deputy editor of the Daily Mail, into the lake. So it was in sheer self-defense that I became a journalist. Our mother was determined we should get on in life. That is why, she said, we were both sent to Rodine School to equip us for the struggle. Anyone who could survive Rodine could survive anything. But in fact, we now think, it was because she was so madly in love with the old school that she always liked to know what was going on there in latter-day detail. She was an old Rodinian of old Rodinians. So were Aunt Eileen and poor dead Aunt Lily, but not so aggressively, somehow. She also determined we must learn to ride. So at 5 shillings an hour, together with other little bourgeois tots, we learnt to walk, trot, and canter round the Newcastle town moor, under the benevolent eye of bowler-hatted Mr. Woods and his son Johnny. Johnny was very gay, and taught the pupils the Charleston on the side, capering wildly in the straw and hay. His red-faced father, Mr. Woods, was an old artilleryman. He is dead now, more's the pity, and so are half the ponies who shared our dreams. Little Bobby, Sammy, Polly, the kicker, Tango, Ginny, who was a bit of a one, and Big Bobby, the police horse. In spite of the fact that my sister Liz was allergic to horses, she had hay fever, this riding, which must have been a terrible expense for our parents, kept everyone very healthy indeed. Once I was run away with in a thunderstorm, and the others fell off in all directions, and I read a book by Nat Gould and pretended to be a jockey. But chiefly, Mr. Woods was concerned with seeing we rode like little ladies and gentlemen, which was jolly nice of him. Eventually, Liz went away to Rodine. Because Mum was an old Rodinian, she had a very unfair advantage over Liz. She knew when she ought to be made a sub-prefect. She knew when she ought to get her cricket colours. She even knew when people were not catching infectious diseases fast enough. Liz tried very hard at Rodine. "I know cricket," she told her husband the other day. "Lift, step, hit." I was listening at the time. "Nonsense, dear," I said. "That's lacrosse." But Rodine was awful. Somehow, we both managed to escape being expelled. Someone threw a lacrosse ball at the maths mistress, struck her on the bosom, and was given castor oil as a punishment. Liz allegedly broke into the white marble school chapel and drank the communion wine, and then, in an advanced state of intoxication, is supposed to have driven the headmistress's niece, with a broken bottle, up onto the roofs. To get there, they went through various lofts, and Liz said there were a terrible lot of disused chamber pots and wickerwork chairs. Later, when I went to Rodine, I found these as well. But don't believe this story, gay though it may be. Sister Liz was only 12 when she left Rodine and went to Mayerton Manor, a perfectly splendid farm school run by Roger Fry's sister. No one ever came to grips with what went on at the farm school, chiefly because Liz was now known as Beth, very confusing. But she certainly sat for her school leaving certificate there and passed with honours, a remarkable feat for a young woman who says she still doesn't know how many feet there are in a yard. This is a singular handicap for a dress designer. Then she went to an art school, attached in the loosest possible sense to Durham University. In spite of the gay social life of Durham University, she won a scholarship to the Royal College of Art and went plunging off to the great wicked metropolis. Eventually, she became a dress designer. Almost directly, film producer Joseph von Sternberg said to her, "You turn an iceberg into a pool of leaping fish." Sir William Rothenstein said, "There is something daintily naughty about your work." And Professor Joad announced, "You have as many big guns for a woman as I have for a man." Sister Liz can't remember her replies to any of these glamorous gentlemen. But when she was pinned up against a wall at a literary party, and an author, breathing heavily down his nose, said, "What do you want most in life?" she replied, quick as a flash, "Brown bread and butter." Which just goes to show that my sister Liz is a corker. Chapter 2. Sister Liz disappeared into the whirl of the rag trade almost without trace. Sometimes she would come down to Rodine and take me out to tea. By this time, she was designer to Dorville, a firm of wholesale manufacturers. She talked mysteriously about the collections. She got engaged and disengaged to various young men as if it was a sport like lawn tennis, and sometimes there were fearful emotional storms. But she was always well-dressed, beautiful, and very funny indeed. She once got thrown against the bathroom taps in a sisterly quarrel, and once she took my entire pocket money for the term because, she said, she was starving to death in London. But on the whole, she treated me kindly, and I loved her. Rodine was a strange and pretty place. A large collection of gabled buildings, with little meaningless towers and quadrangles and cloisters, it stands among grassy swards on the cliffs at Brighton, where it was referred to as the college. People talk about it on the buses as they pass, saying, "All the girls have their own horses," and, "Whenever anyone rings a bell, a mistress answers it." No such luck. There were no bells, so far as I could see, anywhere, let alone anyone answering them. Although the summer is beautiful, southwesterly gales in February along the front at Brighton have to be felt to be believed. The wind sighed along the corridors, lifting the linoleum. Our mother, who went there, still bleeding from the assaults of her 10 ravening brothers and sisters, thought it a lovely place, and the girls ever so ladylike. But by 1931, when I sat my scholarship exam, it was very different. "Shut up! Don't chip in! Girls who spread butter on bread are common," were the three basic rules of life. Anyone who caught anyone else doing anything sneaked sanctimoniously to the staff. Everyone got on everyone else's nerves. Though, of course, there were some good bits. I always got enough to eat on Saturday afternoons if I played in cricket matches. I always have had an appetite like a horse. In the summer, the weather was often divine, and the sky as blue as in the south of France. I can remember moments of rare contentment, just lying face down on the short grass, watching a cricket match in the sun, doing nothing. And various Brighton trunk murderers ran smartly through the grounds, leaving little trails of clues. Oh, and suicides flung themselves off the cliffs almost daily. Rodine Cliffs are almost as good for a suicide as Beachy Head. But apart from this, Rodine was really sad. Girls have to get up so early there, for one thing. Bed at 10 p.m. for the sixth form, and then up at 7, plunging down for breakfast at 8. Young ladies who sleep through all this clanging of bells and thundering of feet can often sleep undisturbed until noon. But in theory, matron crashes round, stripping beds and bundling out any lazy bones found sleeping at scripture time. Scripture, in those days, was taught by Dame Emmeline Tanner, the late headmistress. Dame Emmeline was a tall, powerful lady who weighed about the same as our father. She was not, however, wacky at all. Indeed, the only truly wacky character I encountered all the time I was there was Philippa Crosby, a millionaire's daughter from Johannesburg, who grew up to marry Nicholas Montserrat, who wrote The Cruel Sea. Philippa was wonderful because she had a gramophone concealed in her bedroom and used to play the records of Fred Astaire after dark, with a pin instead of a gramophone needle so matron couldn't hear. Girls and staff at Rodine were, without exception, high-minded, pure-souled conformists. Most of the time, they couldn't make out what I was laughing at. One Sunday evening, for example, a lecture was scheduled, a lantern lecture. This was a good thing, as it meant we could sleep a little in the dark, sitting still, which is always restful. The lecturer was announced as Mademoiselle Baguet. She was a little late. I had just dozed off when I came to with a jerk and found that the entire school was on its feet. And slowly up the middle aisle came a little lady dressed in black Hessian boots with gold tassels, white tights, a green jacket with gold froggings, a dolman, a powdered wig, the lot. With her was another lady, also dressed as a man, but in black. She wore lawyer's tabs, a black trailing cloak. As the entire lecture was in French, I and 280 other girls have never yet discovered what it was all about. The Palace of Versailles was mentioned, and the slides were of dim landscapes, but no one even smiled. And then there was the colour play. Colours were awarded like blues for cricket, lacrosse, tennis. Half colours were awarded for dancing, gym, swimming, fencing, and, of all things, acting. And people of colour standard were allowed to choose a play to act every year, to show the parents how jolly cultured we were all getting. One year, someone chose the Trojan Women. Gertrude Lawrence was one of the parents, fairly obviously top parent. She came down and sat in the front row and watched her daughter Pam performing as Cassandra, the prophetess. Pam was a dear, as a matter of fact, and we all loved her. But it was very unnerving to have what Miss Tanner called England's greatest actress sitting in the middle of the front row. Perhaps ambition suddenly burned in the bosoms of those members of the cricket first 11 who, insecurely got up in cardboard breastplates and little kilts and ill-fitting sandals as members of the Greek army, were waiting round the corner of number 3 house for the 3 blasts on a whistle. This meant they were to storm Troy. Perhaps they saw themselves suddenly appearing with Gertrude Lawrence and Noel Coward in a musical version of C.B. Cochrane's Trojan Young Ladies. Anyway, when the whistle blew, the first 11 went berserk. Heads down, chests out. They raced for Troy as though they were in the Olympics. Breastplates burst, sandals flew, and one spear caught with its top and bottom hard in the door where Cassandra was still calling down woe. And the entire Greek army fell with a reverberating crash into the school orchestra, who were hard at it grinding out a tone poem by an old Rhodian called Greta Tomlin. The resulting crash in the timpani could be heard as far away as Falmer. And no one smiled. Pam got her colours for acting and dancing, I believe. When Gertie was going bankrupt, Pam came to stay with us in Newcastle-on-Tyne and electrified the household by rushing out to pretend to commit suicide on the railway line, a girlish prank which upset Mother. Nobody else minded much, least of all Pam. It takes, I suppose, a fairly extreme sense of humour to cope with a Spain in embryo. I recollect one perfect example of this when I was sitting for my school certificate. An awfully nice examiner, a man, we hadn't seen a man for some months, except through the main gates, called Mr. Rubenstein, arrived to examine our prowess in oral French. I arrived a little early for my session and engaged Mr. Rubenstein in conversation in English. "What an awful time you must be having," I said. "How many horrible little schoolgirls have you examined today?" "Far too many," said Mr. Rubenstein, and sighed. At that point, a very angry French mademoiselle, like something out of Angela Brazil, burst into the room. "Nancy," she cried, "what do you think you're doing?"
"She is taking her French examination," said Mr. Rubenstein. "And what is more, she is doing extremely well."
I am sorry to have to record that I got a distinction in French oral, in spite of the fact that I still do not know the past participle of cueillir, to pick, pluck, or gather. The present headmistress, Miss N.M. Horobin, a thoroughly nice woman, once tried to explain to Morris Ambler and myself that Rodine was just like other schools. "Last Christmas," she said, "when the Southdown buses were stuck in the drive on account of the severe fall of snow, and all the girls were helping to dig them out, several of the girls came to me and said, 'Madam, do please go in and don't catch cold.' Not one thought, you see, that if they missed the last plane to Karachi, they wouldn't be home before Christmas." There are always a large quantity of Indian princesses and things at Rodine, which is, it must be faced, extremely expensive. Even after subtracting extras like individual singing, laundry, fencing, stationery, and school books, our father still had to find about £200 a year each for his 2 daughters, so that they might get on in life. Liz cost £2,000. I cost about £1,500. We both, chiefly because our mother was an old girl, were given bursaries of £70 a year, but I don't think this helped much. Of course, there were all sorts of things we could do to help. I refused to wear any but homemade jibbers. A really swanky jibber, and some girls had about 6 of them, made by Debenham and Freebody, or Former, or Liberties, could run you into 10 guineas a jibber, even in 1931. What is a gibber? Well, the four Miss Lawrences, who founded Rodine in 1885, discovered the first gibber on a dragoman in Arabia. It has elbow-length sleeves, and it looks rather like a sack. Gibbers were abolished in 1935, but there was a lot of fuss made by old Rodinians, who will do anything to hold back time. They said there could be no public spirit without gibbers, and no one smiled. The old Rodinians are a very rich, tremendously reactionary body. They want everything to go on just as it did when they were 17. They would like to sing the same old school songs, eat the same old rissoles, and remember jolly old pals, just as always. Once a year, they rush down to Rodine like the lemmings, those strange Arctic rats who so often commit suicide in droves, play cricket and tennis, thus damaging their middle-aged hearts, and even, in extreme cases, change into gibbers. There is also a sing-song when they get together in a great body and roar out the old songs. My favourite of these is the Cricket First Eleven, which goes, "Oh, the Cricket First Eleven is the best in all the land. It's the one above all others we admire on every hand. May your scores be never failing and your bowling ever true. Oh, noble First Eleven, here's our best of healths to you." This is sung to the South African war hit song, Tommy Tommy Atkins, and when, in 1955, I sang it to Noel Coward in the Ivy, Noel actually cried. He said he would put it in his cabaret and sing it in Las Vegas. Then he said he would put it in a play. This he duly did. When I went to see South Sea Bubble, I was amazed to hear Vivian Lee sing her version of the old song. This she did in Act Two, when, under the influence of strong colonial liquor, finally bonking her dusky would-be lover on the head with a bottle. But I was very dissatisfied to find that Vivian Lee used the wrong tune. I rang her up to complain. "Leslie Bridgewater wrote the tune specially for me," she said. "But it's wrong," I said. "Well then, how should it go?" So poor Miss Lee had to listen to me singing it all the way through on the telephone. I have no record of how she looked, taking it in the other end. But as she mentioned that I obviously enjoyed singing it, she too wept. Joyce Grenfell also likes this song, and in 1954, she sang it in duet with me in a home service program. It was a big success. This song was not written by Aunt Lily. I wish it had been. Aunt Lily, mother's sister, who died at the age of 18 from rheumatism of the heart following too much energetic piano practice, wrote Wimbledonia. This was the rallying call of the school when it was still known as Wimbledon House School for Girls. Aunt Lily was one of the junior music staff. "Cricket, tennis, swimming, drilling, thy dear colours, blue and white, public spirit is thy motto, school of love and school of might, Wimbledonia, fair and free, health and strength belong to thee, Felix Wimbledonia." We used to sing. Perfectly splendid. Noel Coward still calls me Old Wimbledonia, and that is why. Another favourite song contained a list of heroines, Marjorie for captain, Druce for play, and had a rousing refrain. "For all of we, whoever we be, fall short of those heroines old, you see. For all of we, whoever we be, fall short of those heroines old, you see." One summer half term, when, as usual, the school was crawling with old girls, I was running, strictly forbidden, in gym shoes, ditto, through school house, ditto, when a long arm shot out from a marble pillar where the school house bell was tolled. A deep bass voice said in my ear, "Ha, ba, ba, you don't know who I am." I agreed. "Well, I'm Druce for play," said the voice. I don't think I have ever quite recovered from this. But my love of celebrities was basely pandered to at Rodine. At one and the same time, we had gathered there Gertrude Lawrence's daughter, Henry Hall's niece, Edgar Wallace's daughter Penelope, and Miss M.J. Mellenby. Miss Mellenby taught English. She had bright blue eyes and auburn hair, and she once cracked her Achilles tendon clean across doing physical fitness exercises with other members of the staff. Miss Mellenby was a very considerable character indeed, passionately loved by all her house and covertly admired by everyone else. She used to go riding on the downs and could quite often be seen standing negligently about on the school terrace dressed in jumpers, a remarkable thing in itself. Anyway, Miss Mellenby went to be head of Borstal in 1935, and Rodine made headlines in the Daily Mirror. She is now an inspector of HM prisons. And no one at the school could see why the rest of the world found this funny. Chapter 3. On Leaving School and the Choice of a Career was the name of a book that our mother was always reading when we were girls. I'm sure we were a great disappointment to her. She kept expecting us to turn out to be games mistresses or hospital nurses or domestic science teachers. I can't think why, as ever since I can remember, I have been saying I would be a journalist, while Liz has said she would be a dress designer. Nevertheless, Mum dragged both of us round various domestic science colleges, and me, at any rate, round Dartford Physical Training College, before she relaxed and let us do our worst. Poor Mum. Our father was much better able to deal with his embryo spains. Said he, "I am not very well off, and I cannot afford to give you the sort of allowances that other girls get in Newcastle. You will have £50 a year, and you must pay for your clothes and amusements out of that. Board and lodging we provide free." This has always seemed to me a generous arrangement. To everyone's surprise, I now crept furtively down the road to Durham University and enrolled myself as a member of the art school. I was furtive because I knew Liz would disapprove and call me a copycat. I got in free because I made some drawings of people skating and showed them to Professor Main, who was the principal. I went to life classes on Mondays and anatomy classes on Thursdays, and it was a long time before anyone found out about it at home. They were surprised. It was winter time, and I never stopped being amazed by the imperturbable half-frozen male model who stood, shivering slightly, on his throne. He was so dignified. Then one day, someone shouted out, "Was anyone going skating?" "Didn't even know you could skate," replied some other rude beast. "Of course he can. His mother was one," said another. This broke up the model, who laughed helplessly. For some reason, this instantly made him appear indecent. The female models weren't at all shapely, but they were cozy and used to tell our fortunes in the coffee break. I liked the art school very much, but I got rather sick of sitting still making drawings of the sternomastoid movement, and the professor of anatomy was suspicious of me. I was in love at this time too, and while the other girls sat happily at their donkeys, strange wooden things on which to prop a drawing board, with a head one end and a body to sit astride, and roared out songs with swift loud melodies like, "The music goes round and around and it comes out here," I used to brood in a corner humming "Serenade in the Night." I have never been very good at being in love. This time, I was in love with a young man called Paddy something or other. Paddy, because I had such a terrible temper when I was a baby. He danced very well. He was very tall and very good at golf, and even made me play golf for a little while. I found golf very boring. He took me to tea with his mother. She was very suspicious of me, I remember, and there was a flagpole in the garden. He took me to dances. I remember one, particularly in HMS Calliope, the RNVR training ship in the Tyne, when we stood arm in arm on the poop and looked at the lights wiggling in the water. It was all very innocent and rather dull. By and by, Paddy very sensibly married a very rich young woman. My heart certainly wasn't broken, for by this time I was in love with Michael. Michael was very tall and very intelligent. He talked very well, and he laughed a lot, and he didn't dance anything like as well as Paddy. He once took me to a dance and got sick of it, and we went for a long walk through the snow at the back of Tankerville Place, ending up on the little wooden bridge that goes over the railway, at roughly the point where Pam, Gertie Lawrence's daughter, had decided she wouldn't commit suicide. The street lamp shone on Michael and on the snow, and it was pretty. But nothing altered the fact that my feet were wet through. Next day, sure enough, I had a terrible cold, even though the tune, I'm in the mood for love, kept running through my head. And shortly after, Michael married an even richer girl than Paddy had. Mildly sickened by romance, I decided at this point that I needed some exercise. That had always been the cure for sentimentality at Rodine. Run like boys and you won't think about boys, our dear old housemistress used to say. For example, I joined a swimming club, but when I was changing in my little cabin, I heard two girls ask one another if they were staying for the water polo. Do you remember the last time when Joey Latimer got his costume torn off? They said. Somehow, after this, I didn't go back. Instead, one day, I heard there was a lacrosse club in Sunderland. I had never been very good at lacrosse at Rodine. I was in the second 12. But the idea of fresh air and running after a ball always appealed to me strongly. Sister Liz says it is most unnatural. Maybe she is right. Anyway, I used every means I could to get to Sunderland, where, to my surprise, I became a member of the Northumberland and Durham team. In company with 11 other muscular girls, I now travelled the length and breadth of England, playing matches against Lancs, Chess, Yorks, Barks, Bucks and Oxen, and, once a year, Liverpool, where we all took part in the North of England trials. Every year, monotonously, I failed to get into the team. But I made some very good friends, and the sports editor of the Newcastle Journal heard about these goings-on and asked me to write a report for him. It will give your club good publicity, he said. Harry Barker was my first editor. I was 18. He sat in a dim little office with the famous Newcastle Journal clock outside the window. The office smelt of dust, copy paper, and glory, printer's ink. Every now and then he shouted, "Boy!" and a boy called Billy stuck his head in and took away some copy. "Ooh," I said, "I wish I worked here." "Well," said Harry Barker, "maybe you will one day." He was an absolute darling. He was short and pale-faced, and I believe he had been a great footballer in his day. He taught me the basic rules of journalism. "Write clearly," he said, sending me away to write about lacrosse with a big, thick, black, oily pencil and some tiny square sheets of beige copy paper. "Write on one side of the paper only, number each page, and always get your story here by 2:30 at the latest. What's the use of hanging around the pitch waiting for something better to happen if the paper goes to press without your report?" I didn't have a typewriter in those days, and I found it comparatively easy to write standing upright on a frozen pitch, and very thrilling to parcel up my copy in a big red envelope, overstamped Newcastle Journal, and then dash across country to the nearest mainline station. Someone then collected it the other end. When I graduated to more important things, I would put through a reverse charge call saying, "Meet the 2:30 from Darlington." My excitement over the lacrosse matches was worthy of a world scoop at least. Harry Barker didn't pay me anything for these inspired accounts of the Mrs. W. Sargent and N. Sanderson playing like lambent flames along the left wing, but he printed them in the paper over my initials, and he gave me a taste of the power of journalism. Thinking it over, I suppose I ought to have paid him. The Mrs. W. Sargent and N. Sanderson were important figures in my reports. Winifred Sargent was the height of glamour. She was known as Bin to her chums and Girly to her mother. She was so good at games that it was embarrassing, quite adult games like bridge. She had a streak of golden hair and blue eyes with a yellow ring round the pupil, and she could run faster than any girl I have ever seen. To have seen Bin flash down the left wing and shoot a goal was a sporting experience on a par with Bannister's Mile or Obolonsky's Ashbrook Try. But quite apart from this athleticism, Bin was terribly clever and very funny. She made excellent jokes and actually kept double-entry ledgers of personal expenditure, just for the hell of it. She also had a wonderful showing-off flair. For example, She had a little green sports car with cream wings, and she had two wonderful red Irish setters that sat up in the back, looking exactly like an advertisement for sports girl lipstick. Bin was an amazing girl. She drank gin and tonics in a rather lordly way, and she was engaged to be married to a young man called Bill, and then to a young man called Francis. Or was he Roger? It was difficult to tell them apart. Nora Sanderson was Bin's best friend. She was handsome too, but plumper than the great Miss Sargent. He used to fling the ball at me, crying, "Yours, Spain!" For years, our father used to walk round the house, murmuring to himself, "Yours every time, Spain," which used to send him into fits of silent laughter. All the West Hartlepool girls had a lot of money. They lived in big, prosperous houses, with a full quota of maids cavorting in the back premises. They drank burgundy and fizzy lemonade for lunch, and I was mad about them all. I thought they were a very fast set indeed. Considering that I was all the time mooning over Paddy or Michael, they were very nice to me. Then one day, I ran out of money and couldn't afford to pay for my round of gins and tonics. Bin pointed out in words of one kindly syllable how I mustn't allow this to happen again. I had already spent the £50 father had given me on rushing about to Liverpool and so on, and my share of the petrol. What was I to do? I remembered Dorothy Dixon and her deplorable song about the consumptives, and I went down the road to Broadcasting House, New Bridge Street, in Newcastle, and said I wanted an audition. Was I an actress? "Oh, yes," said I, with the courage of despair. I was a very good actress. And I filled up a little form with the help of a commissioner sergeant and said I had played in The Ghost Train and The Importance of Being Earnest and The Trojan Women. Then I went home. A week later, I got a square buff envelope containing a letter signed L. Guildford. He was the new director of the Newcastle station since George Marshall had gone back to Belfast. It said I was to attend for audition at 4 p.m. sharp and be prepared to read a part. So I took The Importance of Being Earnest and The Ghost Train and a very long sheet of paper on which I had written one sentence in every known dialect in the world. I even included an imitation of Mae West. It took at least half an hour to read out all the sentences into a microphone with china sides, quite different from the blue calico affairs I was used to in Children's Hour. From time to time, the terrified young producer at the control panel downstairs, his name was Cecil McGiven, tried to stop me. "But I've several more dialects to do," I said. "Now then, Somerset." In the end, he came upstairs with the Times newspaper. "Read that," he said, "for God's sake, in your normal voice." Years later, Cecil told me, "You gave the most appalling performance anyone has ever given at an audition. But you read a whole single column of the Times from top to bottom without a single mistake, and without a single whistled sibilant. That in itself was remarkable." I still can't see why. It was my mother who taught me to read. Later, Cecil McGiven would go on to say, "A good story, Nancy, but I wasn't the young producer. However, I read the audition report a day or so later. It showed, A, for an amateur actress, you had given an outstandingly good audition. B, the official taking the audition had been through a most unusual experience." A week later, I was asked to come in and read the heroine's part in a dialect play called The Lang Pack. It was a jolly, gloomy story about a girl who lived all alone up the North Tyne and let in a peddler who hid in his pack in order to commit a robbery with violence. The heroine plunged a knife in the pack when she saw it wriggle. She also said a lot of things like, "Nout evor happens oop t' valley, nout te day but watch the coos, or was it the hills, torn frae broon to green to white and back o'er again." Radio studios in those days were just as they are now, with a green light to give you your cue to scream against the background of lowing cows on a gramophone record, a red light to say that if you cough, you will deafen thousands, and a white light to show that something terrible has gone wrong and they want the engineer on the telephone. We had a new sort of microphone again, rather like a copper wasp's nest with holes all over it. I screamed 765 times in that production on a green cue light. Cecil McGiven was a producer who liked perfection. On transmission, I was covered with mud and so tired, I had been playing lacrosse against Lancashire that day, that I croaked like a very old lady, and not at all like the fresh young girls who were supposed to be the heroine watching the hills turn colour. I got 5 guineas and thought it was too easy. But then a letter appeared in the Newcastle Journal, that same journal in whose pages lacrosse notes by NBS had been appearing. "These so-called dialect plays are the worst so-called feature on the so-called region," it said, and the woman was the worst, outraged mother of four, Heaton. There was only one woman in the cast of The Lang Pack, me. Cecil McGiven said, "Guildford and I agreed that if we didn't give you a chance, we would be guilty of stifling regional talent, hence your screams in The Lang Pack. You were also very good looking. As regards the screams, I doubt the number 765. I vouch for the quality. As an amateur actress, you were a remarkably good professional screamer." L. Guildford was most kind about it, however. He lent me a copy of Aylwin by Theodore Watts Dunton, he was the chap who kept Swinburne off the booze, and gave me another minor part in a play almost directly. I think the play was by L. Guildford. It was called A Victorian Drawing Room and contained such fragments of dialogue as, "Oh ho, Mr. Ross, what a quiz you are!" Mr. Ross was a tenor who sang, "Oh, that we two were maying." I got 2 guineas for this. Suddenly, Harry Barker, who believed in lacrosse as a good thing, asked me to go and report a badminton tournament. "I'll pay you 1 1/2 a line." This epic piece of prose was later pasted into a press cutting book, all 50 sizzling lines, where I read it the other day. Roughly 6 bob's worth. Highly excited, I rushed to Sunderland. I found both Nora and Bin playing badminton, bouncing up and down on the rough wooden floor of some converted swimming baths. The fact that their activities were now worth 1 1/2 a line to me made their activities more desirable than ever. Then I caught the last train home, and when I had turned in my copy, the last tram back to Jedsmond had gone. It was my first taste of being a reporter. It had been snowing, and when I came out of the journal offices, the sad, battered old face of Newcastle was hidden under a white mask. Tram lines had disappeared. The overhead wires gleamed silver. Everything was quiet. And I was a reporter. I danced home on wings. When I got to 7 Tankerville Place, it was locked, bolted and barred. I had quite forgotten to tell anyone where I was going. I tried inefficiently to climb in. I fell into a snowdrift. I daren't knock. Our mother would have scalped me. So I broke a window pane and opened the latch through the hole. I got a glazier in the morning from the builder's yard at the back. The pane of glass cost 1 9d. The return ticket had been 3 shillings, so I didn't stand many rounds of drinks at the next match against Yorkshire. But I didn't care. I had a career and, later, I had a latch key. It must have been around this time that Mother began complaining that I treated the house like an hotel. Good old Harry Barker. Everyone was interested in hockey and badminton, he said. He would pay me 1 1/2 a line for them, and when the summer came, and with it lawn tennis, for some reason the price jumped up to 2d a line. Relative prices are always fascinating. And then the Yorkshire Post wrote to Harry and asked him for someone to cover local tournaments for them, and so did the Scotsman. One glittering year, I represented the Yorkshire Post, the Scotsman, the Doncaster Northern Echo, the Sunderland Echo, the West Hartlepool Northern Daily Mail, the Newcastle Journal, and the Newcastle Evening Chronicle. I wrote different lead-in paragraphs for all these stories, and then sent off carbon copies of the strings of results. The results were a godsend. One could fill up lines and lines at 2d with them. My tremendous Northern Counties-wide syndication was a deadly secret. And I remember one wonderful occasion when a local hero called W.T. Anderson said to me, with just a faint hint of patronage, "Why, Nancy, you must be quite right about my weak service. The Yorkshire Post says it is weak too." What with all these carbon copies of results, it was necessary to have a typewriter. Mother very kindly gave me hers. It was a baby empire. I estimated that I had written 3.5 million words with it, 9 books, and heaven knows how many reports of one kind and another, before it collapsed and couldn't even be rebuilt. This generosity and enthusiasm of mother's wasn't a bit spoilt by the muttering that now went on about how I lived on sandwiches and gin and ginger beer and treated the house like an hotel. I also had a little fabric second-hand baby Austin. It cost £20 and, of all things, Bin began to be jealous of the little pile of crumpled postal orders I used to cash before I started out for a match. And I was again in love, with Dick this time. But Dick went to Germany for his summer holes and married a German girl, which was surprising, I must say. For my part, I was so jealous of the West Hartlepool girls and their superior gamesmanship that I decided I must get onto the North Side for something. The only game I have ever been any good at is cricket, so cricket it would have to be, however much my sister Liz sniggered. It was unthinkable for our ace sports reporter not to be on a territorial team for something. So I dressed myself up in a pair of very tight tennis shorts and long white Tyrolean stockings and a cable-stitch sweater and my Rodine cricket cap in order to attract the selector's eye. I stood about in this strange fancy dress, and all I got was a lot of black looks. So, in the end, I went up to one of the selectors. Nice old party, she was too, in a broad straw gents cricketing boater. "Oh, ma'am," I said sycophantically. "I did so enjoy that innings you played against Rodine in 1935.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.